Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody here on this first Sunday of fall. A little gloomy or cozy, however you want to look at it. I like rain, to a degree. I always enjoy this kind of thing. Let's see, we have a couple of announcements. Finance Committee, Treasurers Committee is going to meet on Tuesday of this week, 1:30. At the boardroom, here at the church. And the only other announcement in the bulletin is a reminder that not next week, but the week after, the 7th of October, first Sunday in October, we are going to join Matt's house. The things to remember are, it's at 10 o'clock, not 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and it's at the Hollywood Theater. We're coming to them. And I talked to Rob this week, and basically what we decided would be best is that we're fundamentally just going to be guests there. We're not going to be involved in the service much. I will preach, but that's pretty much it. And we're going to see how they worship. We're going to follow their order of worship. We're going to do things the way that they do them. And I think that will be nice for us, and it will also be a good experience for us and for them. So should be enjoyable. And I hope that everyone will join us at 10 o'clock at the Hollywood Theater. We'll have a minute for mission that will talk about the peace offering. Let that take care of itself. Any other announcements that need to be made? I am Jonathan. This is the day that the Lord has made. And may the peace of Christ be with you all.
Thank you.
things.
Thank you.
knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them."
Second scripture this morning, the text of the sermon comes from the Gospel of Mark, in the 9th chapter. They went on from there and passed through Galilee, being Jesus and the disciples. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" And said, I think we need to tell him, right? "What were you arguing about on the way?" And they were silent. For on the way, they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all, and servant of all." And then he took a little child and put it among them. And taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for speaking to us this morning. Thank you for your willingness to share your word, even in our confusion and our lack of understanding. Open our minds and our hearts to what you would have us learn today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we haven't done this for a while. It's a nice rainy morning. We're going to get all cozied up. So everybody, come on up and fill up these first four rows. Count. I know you all are challenged with this. Four front rows. Thank you.
21, but I do want to point out that our treasurer cannot count to four. And it may be a problem. Now, this is great. This is great. What? Trust me, I have words. I know. Okay, our scripture, both scriptures, the foot washing scripture and the one about children, are about radical servitude. Okay? Radical Christian service. We tend to sentimentalize and romanticize the one about children, but we have to understand that in first century Judaism, in that culture, that Jesus did that, we have to understand that children were, for all practical purposes, non-entities. They weren't at the bottom of the social ladder. They weren't even on the social ladder until they got to be about 12 and could start making a contribution to society. So he didn't take somebody who was poor. He didn't take a Samaritan. He didn't take a Gentile. He didn't take somebody who was at the bottom of the social ladder. He took somebody that wasn't even on the ladder and said, look, this is who you need to welcome and serve. Okay? Couldn't have gone any lower than he went. We need to understand that. Because what I want to talk about with you this morning is about this radical Christian service. So, given our first lesson, I want everybody now take off your shoes, okay? All right. Joking. That's the most dreaded words a Presbyterian could ever hear during a worship service, okay? Take off your shoes. No, do not do that. Please no. I'm a Presbyterian, and I have a confession to make, which is I, first of all, don't really understand what this Christian service is all about when I read scripture about it. Secondly, what I do understand, I do not like. Because we tend, and I do the same thing, we tend to live in a society that says, well, you have to have balance. You have to take care of yourself. In fact, we'll say, you've got to take care of yourself if you're going to be able to take care of others. And there's some truth to that. There's some common sense truth to that. I think Susan would back us up. Soon to be not but that's not exactly what Scripture says. And it confuses me and it upsets me because, you know, we like to look at love our neighbor as ourselves, and we like to focus on that as ourselves, meaning, well, we must love ourselves if we're going to love our neighbor like ourselves. And we cling to that like a drowning man driftwood. But if you really read across scripture, everything Jesus says, everything Paul says, they use words like you have to be a servant to everyone. You have to, in love, serve everyone and be a servant. And the problem is, if you look at the Greek for the word servant, what it really should have been translated as is slave. I just don't like that. And I don't understand. Who are we supposed to be slaves to? How are we going to get anything done if all we do is be slaves to everybody? And it's confusing, and every time I try to figure it out, I end up lightening it up and softening it up. And I don't think it's what he's getting at. Because he also says, you know, you've got to give up your life. You've got to die into your hard work. So I've been wrestling with it. I hope you all wrestle with it. Sometimes stories are a good way to wrestle with these things. And I know a lot of you all probably heard the story about the fellow that had the dream that went to heaven and hell, and maybe I've shared it with you. I don't know. I'm getting up in age. I've been here long enough. I may start repeating myself. If I do, I'm trusting that you all are of an age. We're counting on working together with that. But he had this dream, and he went to hell, and there was these big doors, looked in and it was a banquet hall. And it was the most, it was a table laden with the most wonderful, delicious food that he had ever seen. He looked around and he said, I thought this was hell. And the devil just grinned and said, keep looking. And he looked, and as far as he could see, down this wonderful banquet table were people sitting in chairs on either side of the table, and they were all completely emaciated. They looked like they'd been in some kind of a Nazi concentration camp. Skin and bones, and they were mad and angry and sad and just looked horrible. And he looked and said, what in the world? They have everything right in front of them. And he looked a little more carefully, and he saw that all they had to eat was a spoon like this. And it was inexplicably attached to their hand, so they couldn't choke up on it and chew. They had to eat with this spoon. And so they would get a little bit of food, and they'd start to bring it to the mouth, and by the time they even got it to where it would drop, it had fallen off the spoon. So they had all this wonderful food in front of them. And forced to use utensils that could not bring that to the film. It was forced. It was horrible. And then that kind of faded away, and suddenly he was outside the pearly gates of heaven. And St. Peter was there, and St. Peter opens up the doors of heaven and sees the same scene. This kind of freaks him out, but he thought he was in heaven the first time. It's just this endless banquet table. All the delectable, delicious food you can imagine sitting on. And he looks at everybody's happy, and they look well fed, maybe even a little plump, and they're happy and joking, and he looks further. And he can't believe it. But they all have the same spoon in heaven. It's a miracle. He's watching, and he sees them take the spoon, put a little bit of food in it, and pass it across the table. And every night, he's doing that because their spoons reach to the other person. Not to themselves. Maybe Christian service is a little bit like that, to where we shift our perspective of our own needs. And we don't just look at what we need, but we look at what we have in common with other people's needs. And we share that. And we do it in service. And everyone gets served. Maybe. Maybe it's like that's. Or maybe it's like when I met Alvin. Met Alvin about, I don't know, it's been over 20 years now. And it was the summer before I went to seminary, which is kind of a scary time because I had this whole new thing moving up, going back to school. I went kind of second career, so it was a big shift. So I was trying to mentally prepare to go school to be a minister. And I remember that summer in August, toward the end of the summer, I started seeing this man walking around to different places in my hometown. And he was clearly homeless. Now, my hometown had its share of transients, and the Ministerial Association and Sheriff's Department discreetly took care of those transients. But we had never had a truly homeless man living in our town, staying there, seeing him every few days. And remember, Alvin, he was a big burly man, and he had on this old raggedy winter coat right there in the middle of August. It was like in the heat. And he had long, stringy, greasy silver hair, and this great big bushy kind of Santa Claus beard. That covered up half his chest, and he would walk around, and every so often he would take this imaginary comb and just kind of comb it through his head. And as far as I could tell, all of his worldly possessions went
breeze and grocery bags and carry it around with it.
And when the weather was decent out and would sleep out under the stars, maybe in the park or I don't know where he slept, but I know when it rained, he would oftentimes sleep up under the awning over the sidewalks at the shopping centers. He would sleep there. And sometimes when it was raining, he would spend the night all night laundry next door to the apartment. And I was sitting there thinking, this homelessness was new. I live in a small town in the mountains. I was thinking, okay, I'm getting ready to be a minister. All right, I'm going to go off the center and learn to be a minister. I need to do something for this guy. He's obviously homeless. You know, I need to at least try to, which was scary, because I'd never been around a homeless person, okay? And he was obviously in some mental health issues. And he was a big guy, much bigger than me. So it was a little scary, but I said, all right, if I'm going to be a minister, I need to start acting like one, right? So the next time I saw him over at that laundromat sitting there, I got up all my courage, I walked over. And I stuck up my hand, and I introduced myself, and I said, I'm in. And he said, I'm Alvin. And I sat down and tried to be all casual-like, like I talked to homeless people every day and knew what I was doing, and tried my best not to be condescending, even though obviously I was, because I thought I could help him. So I was looking down on him, but I was trying not to. And I didn't have much to say to him, so I just looked at him and I said, Alvin, are you hungry? And he said, yes, I am. I said, great. I said, can I get you something to eat? He said, yes, I'd like 2 quarter pounds of whipped cheese, a large fry, a large coke, please. And I said, okay, that's specific. If I can take care of that. So I got my car, and I went out to McDonald's, and I got him 2 quarter pounds of whipped cheese and a large fry, a large coke. He said, thank you. I said, you're welcome. And I walked away. Boy, I felt good about myself. Because here I have done something for this homeless man. And I remember I was lying in bed that night, just kind of reliving the scenes in my head and feeling good about helping this fellow out. And surviving. You know, I felt like I was afraid. And then this little niggling thought in the back of my mind as I lay there thinking about this came along and was like, you know, you need to do more than just that. That was good, but that's not enough. And this that whole just irritating WWJD thought came into my mind. It's like, what would Jesus do? And it's like, you know, what Jesus would do is offer. Homeless. Well, I was not happy about this thought, but I could not rationalize my way out. And in all fairness, you know, I wasn't married at the time. I was living by myself. I don't know had I had a family if I would have done this. But I decided I was going to invite out if I lived with it. You know, it's scary. So I waited, and the next time he was over at the laundromat, I went over, and I sat down, and he seemed genuinely happy to see me. Well, he had introduced himself before, and I said, how did you get out? And he said, okay. And that time, we actually started talking a little bit, and I found out he had worked construction all over the country, but was now on disability. He had had an accident, and was legitimately on disability, and he had family down in North Carolina, and was kind of working his way back to North Carolina, and was having a little issue with his government disability checks, and had stopped in my hometown to kind of work that out, and then he was going to, in a few weeks when he could, was going to get all to North Carolina. And it kind of became a real person, not just out in the homeless guy. And so I was talking, and I was stalled, okay? I was stalled. I didn't want to ask. And I said, Alvin, are you hungry? And he said, yeah, I am. I said, you want another 2 quarter pounds of whipped cheese and large fries and a large goat? He said, I sure would. And so I got in my car and went to the college and taking up time and came back and gave it to him. And he said, we were sitting there
time that I worked up my courage and I looked at it, right? And I said, "How?" So I know you're going to have a place to live. So until you can get things worked out, get back to North Carolina, I've got to, if you'd like to, come and live in my place. And he looked at me with genuine surprise. His eyes got big. And then he just kind of smiled at me and said very softly and gently, "Okay." And the biggest rush of relief that I know helped in my life passed through me. But it was also followed immediately by some disappointment. Because that would have been an adventure. That would have been a bigger adventure than what I'm able to share with you all without it. And you know, I never saw Alvin again after that. Maybe he thought I was weird. I don't know. But it's just like he vanished in the thin air. I never saw him again. But within a month, I was out of Iowa in seminary. And without my having anybody who had known this was going to happen, my living arrangements ended up putting me in a situation where I was offered a position as a director of a homeless shelter. And I can tell you right now, had I not fought through that relationship with Alvin, had I not mustered up the courage to actually sincerely offer my home to him, there's no way in the world I would be in the city working in that homeless shelter. And I worked there all in all, mostly. The whole time I was in seminary. And it was a profound and life-changing event. And I don't know who Alvin was. And I don't know where he went. I don't think it was a coincidence that the only homeless man that ever stayed in my hometown and I was growing up living came along just a few weeks before I was out. So maybe this Christian service is about us looking beyond our own circumstances and our own situations to truly see and become involved in other people's circumstances and worlds. As scared and as hard as it can be sometimes, take that leap of faith and really open yourself up to their situation and serve them. Or maybe it's like our friend Jim Miller, who is a Presbyterian minister out in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And he's got a great big huge church out there. And there was a day when he and one of his associate pastors were out trying to visit a parishioner, and this was before GPS. And so they just had an address, and they'd gone into this huge suburb. It was one of these just gigantic developments that are just like mazes, and you get in them, and all the streets look the same, and all the houses are just tiny variations of the same cookie-cutter house. And they had gone down one street and turned off to another that looked just the same, and were pretty much lost. And finally turned down this one street that had a cul-de-sac at the end of it, and as they drove through the cul-de-sac, Jim saw something that caught his eye. He saw a couple getting out of a car in the driveway of one of these cookie-cutter houses. And what he saw just lighted him no end, because they were in this passionate embrace. I mean, the man had his arms completely around the woman, and the woman had her head buried in his chest, and Jim was like, "Oh my God." Right here in the middle of the suburbs where just infidelity and cheating on each other is just rampant. It's just known for that. The divorce rates are so high in America and in this area. And here is a couple, and they weren't teenagers either. They were great around the 50s. This was a middle-aged couple. And here was this delightful middle-aged couple just passionately embracing each other, still on fire for each other, right here in the suburbs.
then he saw the wind. And he watched as that man gently and lovingly set his flock to his wife and his children. He rolled her into that house as he surely done thousands of times. Into that haven of immeasurable sacrifice. And I wonder at that time, I wonder if what it takes to understand this level of service that Jesus talks to us about is an entire shift in our world where we no longer see things the way we want to see them. We no longer project our hopes and dreams on top of these images, as beautiful as those hopes and dreams are. But we open our eyes and see the real beauty that's the sacrificial life. I'm going to think about a life I struggled to begin with. I think we're all right. Thank you.
I was going to tell you a story, and then Calvin thinks this is storytelling time, so he's a very hard act to follow. I want to tell you a story about a boy named Princeton. And he was 13 years old, and he was running an errand for his mom. He could have been one of the wives for Giant. And he was kidnapped. Now that didn't happen here. That happened, Princeton lived in Nigeria. And he was off to fetch water for his mom. And he was snatched by soldiers. Within 2 weeks, Princeton was carrying a gun. One day his unit was under heavy fire and a rocket landed that hadn't exploded. And I guess he was ordered to try and defuse this rocket. And as you might imagine, it exploded. Princeton endured 6 surgeries after that without anesthesia. Finally, at the age of 17, he came home to his mother. But I don't think the Lord was done with Princeton yet. Christ came into his life and he professed his Christian faith. They eventually moved to the United States, and Princeton is now the pastor of the First Presbyterian Church in Midlothian, Texas. He is active and not passive, and through our participation in the Free Peace and Global Witness Offering, we are hoping through peacemaking and reconciliation ministries of the Presbyterian Church to stop anti-trafficking work related to forced labor, sex trafficking, and the conscription of child soldiers like Princeton. Let us offer peace of Christ at all times and always. Let us pray. Liberating God, we pray today for people around the world who yearn for freedom. Help us to be instruments of your deliverance in the struggle against human trafficking. May we bear witness to the full and free life that you want for all people. Amen.
Financial blessings by giving thank offerings for what you have given us. Amen.
and share with you some joyful concerns that folks have shared this morning. And ask for prayers for Joan's daughter, Barbara. Prayers for Kelly's friend, Rob. Kelly said that she had friends in the Army, and pray for Kelly for continuing healing. So, also want to pray for Susan's brother, Ray, who's having a heart surgery this Thursday. Keep Evelyn Galvin in your prayers. She sprained her ankle and she's home and recovering from that. Also with the Galvin family, to continue to pray for Linda Galvin, Evelyn's daughter-in-law, who was in a car wreck, sustained some injuries, some fractures, got some bruises and concussions. Pray for the Dingle family, their members of Relay, and the Kittles in the last stages of ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. Keep that family in your prayers. Ron Hicks has a neighbor, Ed, who has just found out that he has prostate cancer, so keep him in your prayers and his family as they begin that journey. And all of those who are suffering and struggling with mental health issues. We also think we need to pray for the Charlestown community with the tragedy of the murder-suicide that happened over the weekend there. That's going to be upsetting to the whole community. So please keep those prayers in your heart this morning as we go to God in prayer, and continue throughout the week. I want to share with you this morning for our morning prayer, a prayer that's attributed to St. Francis that I know we're all familiar with, but it's always good to hear it from him. So let's pray. Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is error, the truth. Where there is doubt, let me sow faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in partnering that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Lord, we lift up these prayers this morning in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught his own disciples when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive
serve as you have been served by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May the entire band of angels surround all of you as you do the good work.